see Lahti just kind of stormed in. Good to see you. Nice to have you.
I'm a storm.
No, that's in the middle of a lot.
In the middle of a lot.
Yes.
Please evaluate our gussied up surroundings.
It's beautiful. I haven't been here in a while.
Right.
Yeah.
It's changed.
Yeah.
It gussied up.
It's completely gussied up.
Yeah.
This movie, Becks, one of your co-stars, Mira Savino, was here to talk about it. You guys obviously have a lot of affection for this movie.
We love this movie, yeah. My part in it is a little smaller. I play the nun mom of Lena Hall, who's come home, and she's a lesbian, and she's come home to get her life back together and trying to, I guess, find a common ground with her mother, and it's a challenge.
But that sounds like very rich material, as you described.
Yes.
So is that what was the most appealing part to you, or...?
Yes, it was really rich material, and the character was fascinating. And, you know, it was a challenge for me. I didn't know how to get inside the skin of someone who is so intolerant, right? So, because I'm, like, completely...
Not that way.
Not that way.
Right.
I'm the opposite.
Yeah.
So how, and being a mother, how do you reject your child who chooses to love someone who you don't approve of, and then you reject them because of that? It was really hard to get into, but I found a way.
So, okay, without revealing your secrets, did you find a way this is a real life example of that, or what? How did you find a way?
I found a way in that, you know, I think my character was afraid of the unknown, afraid of not being like her mother and like my character, and just afraid that her daughter might have a tougher life because of this, being gay. I think mostly it was driven by fear, and I can certainly understand fear.
All right, well, here is a clip of this movie. A lot of people are talking about it. It's called Becks. Watch.
I never trusted her, honey. Too much eyeliner means she's hiding something, obviously, and all that money from her parents.
Mom, you didn't like her because she was a her.
Excuse me very much. I'll have you know that I went to the gay festival this year. Gay Pride Festival. And I wore a t-shirt with a rainbow, and I danced with a lovely man in 4-inch heels. Hey, listen. I don't care if you want to date a person who's a man or a woman who wants to be a pansexual.
Okay, Mom, I get it. Don't hurt yourself.
You know, but what's good about that, and when Mira was here as well, these clips play so real.
Yeah, they do seem very real. And I think the first-time directors, Dan and Liz, had a lot of rehearsal with us, and we got to improvise and really find the characters and the relationship. So that was fantastic.
Also a new book for you?
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Here comes the book cover. Well, I've said this a million times. People often have a greater sense of pride or ownership of the book than anything else they've ever done. Because it's tangible, because you can hold it in your hand.
Yes, and also...
I like this true story from an unreliable eyewitness.
Thank you. I have been interpreting other people's stories my entire career for 40 years, and I finally decided to write my own. And that's been really empowering and fun and scary. Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. You embark on the process.
Yes.
Then either the galleys or you sort of see it in print.
Yeah.
And when you saw it...
Oh, my God. Mm. I wanted to rewrite everything.
Oh,
and
really?
was the writing or that you had told too much or what?
No. Well, I am very vulnerable in it.
Right.
I'm as honest as I can possibly be. And my editors at Harper Wave, at Harper Collins, were saying, more honest, more honest, more honest. My daughter would read and say, come on, get more honest.
Really?
So,
wow.
Yeah, so I did. It's honest and funny, and I hope. But yeah, it's very vulnerable making. It's, again, I've always stood behind a character.
Sure.
I could hide behind someone else's words. And these are my words and my stories and my heart.
And is some of it, say, in atmospheres we'd recognize on the sets of things that we would know? Or?
There's not a lot of show business
in
it. There's some. It's mostly my navigating through a kind of ultra-patriarchal, typical 50s family life as a kid, and then as a feminist trying to navigate through the sexism and ageism of show business, but with humor, because we have to have
humor. And then here are phrases which I think now have been repeated so often, they're almost cliche. Do you think there is this moment and all these things that have transpired because of Me Too?
Not just a moment. It is such a reckoning and a movement, and I have been dreaming about this my whole life.
And did you ever think it would happen?
I hoped. And you see, you saw little, you know, little tiny baby steps with Anita Hill and little tiny movements and steps. And suddenly, the world feels like it's changing and women are being heard and believed. And it's so heartening to me.
All right. To me, that is part one.
Yes.
And then part two, which perhaps is less to a degree, is this notion of ageism, which I think exists in a colossal way.
Well, I think it's all connected because sexist ageism, right? Because women have a much harder time with growing older than men because of sexism. Women are told after a certain age, go out to pasture. And I was hit with this tsunami of ageism in show business, or, you know, my late 50s. And I decided I was not going to drown in it, and I was not going to go away and shut up. So I wrote a book, and I'm going to turn it into a one-woman show. And
there you go.
Yeah.
Look at that.
You have to.
Right.
You have to.
Good. Well, for you. All right. Here's all things Christine. Becks is available on demand, and the book, True Stories from an Unreliable Eyewitness. That title's so fantastic. Yeah. A Feminist Coming of Age drops on bookshelves April 3rd. Will you have to come back for that then?
I would love to.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Christine.
Nice to see you.
Thank you. Yeah.